Welcome back. I'm Robert Breaker, and this week's sermon will hopefully be a blessing to you. I've received a lot of emails from people asking this question. Brother Breaker, how do you read the Bible? How's the best way to take the Bible and read it? How should you read the Bible? I had other people email and say, well, how do you think is a good way to study the Bible? And I thought those were good questions, so I figured, well, let's just kill two birds with one stone, and I'll make a sermon, How to Read and Study the Bible. Now, we've been studying some really, really, really profound stuff lately as we're going through the book of Acts, and we're looking at Paul, and we looked at the apostles' doctrine, and we looked at different things like that. So we've got a lot of meat lately. So I thought, well, you know what? This week we'll have a little bit more milk. So I'll just give you a basic, simple message. Hopefully it'll be a blessing to you. And talk about how to read and study the Bible. Now, I personally, when I read the Bible, I go through the Old Testament once and the New Testament twice. So when I read through the Bible, I read through the whole Old Testament. Then I come to the New Testament, I read the New Testament all the way through. And then I start over in the New Testament and read it through again. Then I go back to the Old Testament. And that's just the way that I personally like to read the Bible. There's a lot of good stuff in the New Testament that's important and is for us today. So I want to get more knowledge of the New Testament than the Old. So I read the New Testament twice and the Old Testament once. That's just how I do it. And it's a good thing to do, especially if you're a new Christian. It's a great thing to do because you need to be acquainted with and understand and know some of the things that are in the New Testament. But the Old Testament is good too. There's a lot of life lessons in the Old Testament. God gives a lot of things in the Old Testament that are good, that are lessons for us to learn, especially about this guy did this and this happened to him. Well, God is saying don't go do that so it doesn't happen to you. So the Old Testament's fun to read, but I want to get the doctrine for the church age today. So I try to read the Bible through Old Testament once, New Testament twice, then back to the Old Testament and read it through again. That's just personally how I do it. But today we're going to look at some things. And what I want to do, I want to start with 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 13. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 13. Here we read Paul speaking, and Paul says, "For this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when ye received the word of God, which ye heard of us, ye received it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe." Now, there's a lot of things in these verses. Paul is saying, I thank God that you received the word of God. That's what the Bible is. The Bible is the word of God. A lot of people say, no, that's man's word. Man wrote the Bible. Man wrote the Bible. Well, the Bible tells us that men actually wrote the words down. But it tells us that God moved those men to write God's words, not man's words. So the word of God is not man's word, it's God's word. So the Bible is God's love letter for us today. And God gave us his words, and that's what the Bible is. So we need to read God's word. And look at what it says here in this verse. It says that God's word works in you that believe. So if you're a believer in Christ, if you're a Christian, if you're saved, if you're born again, then you should read daily the word of God. Because it will work in you, effectually will do something, it will help you as you read the Word of God. So it's important to read the Scriptures. Now, let's look first of all at the word read, and then we'll look at the word study. And I'll show you a little bit about how to read the Bible and how to study the Bible. Let's start in the Old Testament and look at some verses here in Deuteronomy chapter 17. I'll show you a couple Old Testament verses about reading the Word of God and what it's called, and then we'll look at a New Testament verse, and then we'll look at some Old Testament verses about study and some New Testament verses about study. So let's begin in Deuteronomy chapter 17 and verse 19. Deuteronomy 17, 19. "And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God, and to keep all the words of this law and these statutes to do them." So here, it's talking to a king of Israel. And God is telling a king of Israel, look, you should have it, the Bible. And you should read the Bible all the days of your life. And that's what we as Christians should do. We should read the Word of God every day, all the days of our lives. And it's something that God wants us to read. Now, let's go to Psalms. A couple more passages. There's a word that's also affiliated with reading the Bible. And I think this is quite an interesting word. Look at the first Psalm, Psalm 1, 1 and 2. David loved the Word of God. He spent much time reading the Bible. And Psalm chapter 1, verse 1 and 2 says, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night." I just like that word, meditate. What you should do is you should take time to meditate with Jesus by reading his word and just meditate upon the word. Just read the Bible and just say, "Wow, what is that saying to me? What does it say?" God will speak to you through his word if you'll read it. Psalms 119, verse 48, longest chapter in the Bible. Psalm 119, and the whole chapter is about reading the word. Psalms 119, 48 says, "My hands also will I lift up unto thy commandments, which I have loved, and I will meditate in thy statutes." So David is saying, "I will spend time reading your word, Lord." Verse 78 in the same chapter, "Let the proud be ashamed, for they dealt perversely with me without a cause, but I will meditate in thy precepts." What are the precepts? The word of God. And then verse 148 as well. 148, "Mine eyes prevent the night watches that I might meditate in thy word." Even at night, when he couldn't sleep, David says, "I got up and I would read the Bible." So that's something we as Christians should do. I know a lot of Christians that claim to be Bible believers, but very few are actually Bible readers. And that's what God wants. He wants us to know what he says. He wants us to meditate upon his word. Now let's look at a New Testament passage. Here we go to 1 Timothy chapter 4. And in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 13 through 15. Notice what it says. 1 Timothy 4:13, "Till I come, give attendance to reading." To reading. What did Paul want him to read? The Bible. So give attendance to reading. Read the Bible, to exhortation, to doctrine. "Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the presbytery. Meditate upon these things, give them thyself wholly to them, and thy profiting may appear to all." So read, the Apostle Paul says, and meditate. Meditate on what you're reading. So as you read the Bible, you should study, look up things, and then think about, what is that telling me? And should I follow that? Yes, of course you should, but is that something that God would have me to do? Good question. Questions you can ask when you read the Bible. Now, let's look at the word study. The Bible uses the word study three times. Three times do we find the word study in the Bible. And that's in the form of study. That's all it says is study. There's another two times where the word shows up. Studieth. In the Old English, studieth. He that studieth. So let's look at those. Let's go to Proverbs 15:28 first. And I'll show you each one of the verses. Well, I think I'm leaving one out. I'm going to show you four of the verses. Three that say study and one that says studieth. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 28. These are all interesting verses. By the way, if you get a new version of the Bible, most of the time the word study is removed. That's quite revealing. That's quite interesting that new Bibles don't want you to read them. They don't want you to study them, because if you study where new versions come from, you find out they're not the Word of God. They come from corrupt, perverse texts that men have perverted and changed. And they don't come from the pure line of text from where the Bible says the Word of God was to come from. So watch out for new versions of the Bible. Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 28. Proverbs 15:28 says, "The heart of the righteous studieth to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things." The heart of the righteous studieth to answer. You know, that we ought to know how to give an answer to every man. How? Well, we should have a scripture. Anytime someone asks us a question, we should say, "Well, the Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible says." We should always be able to answer with scripture. Now, there's a book called the Book of Ecclesiastes. Let's go to Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 12. I'm going to show you the three verses in the Bible that use the word study. Ecclesiastes 12:12, we read, "And further by these, my son, be admonished, of making many books, there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. Boy, that's true. Sometimes when you're studying, you get so tired. Some of you that have been in school, or maybe even in a secular college, or Bible college, you have to study for your finals and your exams, and isn't it funny that while you're studying, you just kind of doze off a little bit, because sometimes you're working your brain out. You see, studying is working the brain, or the muscle, or it's not even a muscle, it's working your brain. But the brain is like a muscle, because the more you exercise it, the more you use it, the better you'll get. But it's easy sometimes studying to wear out. I don't know why that is, but sometimes the harder you study, the easier it is to just fall asleep. But God wants us to study. Even though it's weariness of the flesh, He wants us to study. So sometimes it's a sacrifice to read the Bible because you get so tired. But God wants you to read it. He wants you to hear from Him. The other place is 1 Thessalonians 4:11. 1 Thessalonians 4:11 says, "And that you study to be quiet, and to do your own business, and to work with your own hands as we commanded you." Now, I don't know why that is, but it says you study to be quiet. So you study the Bible, you get in a place where you can be alone, you can be quiet, you can spend some time with God as you study His Word. And it's usually better when there's no distractions around. When you're distracted, it's really hard to read the Bible. Now, 2 Timothy 2:15. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15 is the final verse in the Bible that tells us to study. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." Now, if you have a New King James Bible, they take out the word study. Why do they do that? Why don't they want you to study and rightly divide? I thank God for the King James Bible, and I'm glad we have it so we can study and we can learn how to rightly divide the word of truth. So, how should we read and study the Bible? That is the question. Well, first of all, I think we should read the Bible, number one, daily. Daily. We should daily read the Bible. That's the best thing to do. Every day, make up in your mind, you know, every day I'm going to do everything I can to set a time out for God. Maybe I have to wake up a little earlier in the morning, but every day I get up, I'm going to read the Bible. Someone said if you read, I think it was it 5 or 10 chapters a day in 1 year, you would get through the entire Bible. I think that was interesting. I don't remember exactly if that was right. I'd have to add up all the chapters in the Bible. But we have a church here where I live and around this area that every year they do a Bible reading. And I don't know where they got the number from, but it's a tradition that they have done for years. And every year the pastor encourages the church to read through the Bible in 55 days. It is possible to read through the Bible in exactly 55 days. And every year sometimes I hear from them, we don't have anything to do with that church, don't go there. But oftentimes I'll hear some people that say they go there and they say, "Yeah, this year I did my 55 days, I finished the Bible." Can you imagine reading through the entire Bible in 55 days? But that's what they do. I think that's interesting. So you need to get a time where daily you'll get it together with God. You know, the Word of God, look what it says in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 11. The Word of God is like bread. Well, I don't know anybody that doesn't eat every day. But there's a lot of people that don't eat spiritually every day. Matthew chapter 6, I might have said 5. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 11, Jesus says these words. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 11. Jesus is speaking and He says, "Give us this day our daily bread." Well, if you eat physically every day, and I don't know very many people that, you know, skip a meal. Most people eat 3 times a day. If you eat every day and take something into your body for the nourishment of your body, shouldn't you eat every day spiritually? Well, the Word of God is like bread. Remember what Jesus said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God." Luke 4:4. So the Word of God is like bread. So if you're going to eat a meal every day, why aren't you eating spiritually from the Word of God, the bread, every day? So it's a good thing to get in the habit of reading the Bible every day. One thing you could do, which is quite interesting, is you could do this. This is something that my wife and I have done for years. Read a chapter of Proverbs every day. The book of Proverbs has 31 chapters. Well, most months have either 30 or 31 days. So what you could get in the habit of doing, along with your regular Bible reading, hope you don't make this your regular Bible reading, you need to read the whole Bible, but what you could do is every single day, you could sit down and say, I'm going to read a chapter of Proverbs, and I'm going to read that chapter that lines up with the day. So this is, I guess, February 2nd, I guess. So I would go to Proverbs and read chapter 2. Let's say it was February 20th. Well, then I would read chapter 20. Now, if I get to February and it's a leap year and I get to 28, well, I might as well read 28, 29, 30, 31. And then the next day is the first. Well, I start over at the first. And every single day of your life that goes by, you could read one chapter of Proverbs that lines up with the day of the month. A lot of people do that. That's a wonderful way. Proverbs has a lot of wisdom. It's one of the wisdom books. So if you read a proverb a day, and each day you read the chapter that corresponds with the date or the day of the month, boy, you could get a lot of wisdom from the Word of God. So that's a good way to read the Word of God, is read daily. And there's many ways that you could read daily. Secondly, we need to read the Word of God dispensationally. When you read the Bible, you need to always ask, who is it talking to and when did it take place? A lot of Old Testament passages you're reading, you need to understand, well, who is this speaking to? What's it talking about? Now, I've got a video on different dispensations. If you haven't seen it, go to YouTube and look up my video on dispensations. And I talk about all the different dispensations. And I'll just briefly put them up here quickly. You have the Edenic dispensation. You have the dispensation of conscience. You have the dispensation of government. You have the dispensation of family, or patriarchy is the better way of saying it, family. And then you have the dispensation of the law. Then you have here the church age. And you got this little time, the tribulation, which we really don't mention because it still goes back to being under the law, because the church is kind of a parenthetical thing. And then over here you have the millennial kingdom of Jesus Christ. So a good way to study the Bible is when you're reading the Bible, whether you're in the Old Testament or New Testament, is you say, now, who am I reading, who is he writing to, and where was he when he was writing? Am I reading the book of Genesis, which talks about a lot of this stuff back here? Am I reading in James, which more applies to the tribulation period? Am I reading in Paul, which applies to this church age period? Where am I when I read the Bible? What dispensation am I in? You see, a lot of so-called Christian denominations, they just take the whole Bible and try to apply it to themselves for doctrine. They don't understand. No, there were certain dispensations for certain people or groups, but we're not in those dispensations today. So you got to be careful about that. And always keep in mind, when I'm reading the Scriptures, what dispensation am I reading? Who is it dispensed to? The word dispensation is actually found four times in the Bible. Let's look at Ephesians 1:10 quickly and look at those verses. I think it's important to realize that the Bible has dispensations. I've heard preachers say, I don't believe in dispensations. And I'm just like, what? So you take the whole Bible for yourself. Is that okay? Then when's the last time you went and built an ark? I mean, that was something that was for Noah way back there to do. You can't apply the entire Bible to yourself. There's different dispensations in which God worked in different times in different ways with different people. We are now in the one where it's the age of grace, where we're saved by grace through faith, by trusting, here it is, the blood of Jesus Christ. How could someone have trusted the blood of Jesus Christ in the Old Testament if Jesus hadn't shed his blood? So you've got to understand what the Bible teaches. And you've got to understand dispensations. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 10, Paul says that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. So that's one time that the word dispensation appears. It appears again in 1 Corinthians 9:17. Let's go there. 1 Corinthians 9:17. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9:17, for if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me. God dispensed or gave unto Paul something to preach. It's the gospel. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 2. If you heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you, word. God dispensed some grace to Paul and told Paul, here, go preach this. And so we're under Paul's gospel and ministry today for salvation. And finally, Colossians 1:25, again we find the word dispensation. Colossians 1:25 says, whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. So there are some things that God dispensed to different people in different times. People say, but I don't believe that. I don't believe in dispensations. And I just say, why not? Have you ever read the book of Hebrews? The very first verse in the book of Hebrews teaches dispensations. Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 1 says, God, who at sundry times, that means different times, and in diverse manners, means in different ways, spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets. So there was different times, sundry times, in various manners or diverse manners that God dealt with people in the Old Testament. Those are called dispensations. So when you read through the Bible in the Old Testament and the New Testament, you always need to ask, which dispensation is this? And that's a good way to read. Now, another way to read the Bible is chronologically. Now, you can do this. I like to do this. I did this before, and I probably will do this again. But I looked up when the books of the Bible were literally written. And then I put them in the order that they were written, and I read through the Bible in the order of when the Bible was written. And that was very eye-opening. That was very interesting. I've done that especially in the New Testament. You read the books in the order of when they were written. Right now, we're going verse by verse through the epistles of Paul chronologically in order of when his books or epistles were written in order to understand better the doctrine. So that's another way you can read or study the Bible is chronologically. Look it up when the dates of the books are and then read each book in order of when that book was most likely written. Another way is read the books in the order, I guess we'll call it in a pre-millennial order. Now this is quite interesting and quite easy to do because the King James Bible is in a pre-millennial order. You see, whenever they printed Bibles in the old days, they didn't have the books in the exact order that we have them today in our King James Bible. Many old Bibles had some of the books, but they were all turned around in different places, and they had some of the Apocrypha just put in a different place, all in together. And if you looked at an old Bible from about the 1400s, you would be like, well, I can't find the books, because they're all intermingled all different places. But the King James Bible, the King James translator said, we're going to put these books in the Bible in a certain order. And they did so, and they put them in a pre-millennial order. I have a video about this on YouTube. I believe it's called The Order of the Books of the King James Bible. If you haven't seen that, look that up. And what that shows is that God, through the King James translators, put the Bible together and where he had them put his books in an order. And that order that the books are in point to how history will unfold. Let me give you an example. The first seven books in the Bible, in the Old Testament, are Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, and Judges. Well, interestingly enough, those first seven books line up with the seven churches, or with the church age. A lot of people will go to Revelation and say, well, the seven churches, that lines up with the church age as time periods. And so they take the seven churches and they divide this up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now I've got 8. But then they'll divide this thing up. There we go, 7. And they'll say that the time periods of the seven churches, it lines up chronologically with the time of the church age, 2,000 years. So what would be the first one? Ephesus. E-S-P-T-S-P-L. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So I got an extra thing over here. Well, the last church period would be Laodicea. What is the last church period? It's the one that's in apostasy. It's the bad church. So it's interesting that the first seven books in the Old Testament are seven books, and the last one is the book of Judges. Judges. What is the book of Judges about? Well, the book of Judges would line up with the seventh church, the last one in the church age, the apostasy. The book of Judges was about apostasy in Israel. And it says, and every man did that which was right in his own eyes. They weren't following God. They were doing their own thing, just like Laodicea. They are not doing right. They're doing their own thing. What is the very next book in the Old Testament? Well, then comes Ruth. What is the book of Ruth about? The book of Ruth is about this woman who was a Gentile who has a redeemer that marries her. Well, the rapture comes, according to the Bible. And that's when Jesus Christ, the kinsman redeemer, comes back to marry his bride. Ruth's a type of that. What comes next? 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 Kings, 2 Kings, 1 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles. Those are all different historical books, but they all have a theme in common. Those books have this one theme in common. First a bad king, then a good king. As you read through those books, they all mention two guys. They all mention King Saul and King David. Who came first? Saul. Then came the good king, King David. Which are a type of what will happen in history. What happens after the rapture? The Antichrist, the bad king, comes. And then Jesus Christ, the good king, comes. So it's interesting how those Old Testament books are in order. Let's continue and look at this. After 2 Chronicles is Ezra and Nehemiah. What is Ezra and Nehemiah? Well, Ezra and Nehemiah, one of them is about the rebuilding of the walls of Jerusalem. The other book is about rebuilding of the temple in Jerusalem. Wait a minute. In the tribulation period after the rapture, the Jews build their temple. Huh. Isn't that interesting? And then you look at the book of Esther. What is the book of Esther about? The book of Esther is about a woman who's a Jew who marries her king. Why? The Jews, when Armageddon takes place, will then be here in the millennium under their king, Jesus. Whew. Interesting. And then it's Job is the very next book. What is Job? Job has exactly 42 chapters. Isn't that interesting? And we're told that the last half of the tribulation, in which the Jews have to suffer as they flee from the Antichrist, will be exactly 42 months. Job is a perfect type of a Jew in the tribulation, in the last half of the tribulation period. Then you've got Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, and then you've got all these other prophets. Many of these prophets, if you read these prophets, with Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, especially Daniel, all of these prophets, most of them, are all talking about the tribulation period and the millennium. So that Old Testament in the King James Bible is put out in a premillennial order of a premillennial of things that take place before the millennium. And you look at the order, you look at it in type, and it perfectly fits a pre-tribulation rapture and a premillennial coming of Jesus Christ. How about the New Testament? Well, yeah, the New Testament's in order as well. The New Testament starts with Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Well, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, like I've said on many occasions, are still Old Testament until Jesus actually dies. And they all show when Jesus dies, so part of them apply over here, but the majority of those books apply before Jesus died on the cross. Until he actually died, that's still Old Testament. Then comes the book of Acts. So Acts is coming, and then comes the books of Romans through what? Philemon. So Romans through Philemon are the books of the apostle who? Paul. He is our apostle for today. Now, what's the last book? The last book is Hebrews. So the last book that Paul wrote, which I believe Paul wrote, he wrote Hebrews. Isn't it interesting that it's called Hebrews? Because after the rapture, then Jesus comes back to those Hebrews or those Jews and begins dealing with them. So, I believe that the book of Hebrews has a lot of doctrine in it that will apply to those Jews in the tribulation. So, do you see how the New Testament is in order? Now, I skipped something. I forgot the book of Titus. In the book of Titus, Paul says, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. That sounds like the rapture. The very next book that Paul wrote is the book of Philemon. Do you know what the book of Philemon is about? The book of Philemon is about a slave that ran away from his master, but now comes back. Well, you have these people called the Jews that rejected their master, Jesus, but then they come back to Jesus in the tribulation period. Whew. It's uncanny how it's in order. A lot of people say, and especially today, many people have emailed me and said, well, Mr. Breaker, we don't believe in the rapture. There's no rapture. Yeah, well, no rapture, but it's right there in the order of the books of the Bible. It's right there if you look at the order of the books of the Bible. What's the next book? James. The book of James. Who is the book of James written to? The very first verse says, to the tribes scattered abroad, to the Jews. Then you have 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. There's some weird things in those books. It's hard to make match Paul, but they sure work well if it's applying to a Jew in the future. Then you have Jude and Revelation. What does Revelation talk about? Revelation starts talking about a church, then a rapture, then a tribulation, then the millennium. So the King James translator put the New Testament and the Old Testament in an order in such a way that the order pointed to the way that the prophecy is to be set up. So that's an interesting way to study the Bible. And you should study the Bible that way. You should remember, hey, the Bible's written with many types in it, and the types all line up to history being this way, this setup. Now, another way to study the Bible is by studying the book of Isaiah. Here's an amazing thing. The book of Isaiah has 66 chapters. There are 66 chapters in the book of Isaiah. There are also 66 books exactly in the book, or in the Bible. Now, someone hypothesized that each book of the book of Isaiah lines up with the 66 books in the Bible in this order of the King James Bible. And you know, only God could do that. So I did that one time. I did that study and I started reading Isaiah. And I wrote above each chapter of Isaiah the book of the Bible that it would correspond with. And you know, some of it, it's hard to see. It's hard to find. But then other things are like blatant in your face. How many books in the Bible in the Old Testament? 39. How many books of the Bible in the New Testament? 27. That makes 66 books. So, the last book in the Old Testament is the book of Malachi, meaning that the 40th book would match with the book of Matthew. So I said, I want to see if that works out. So I went to the Isaiah. I looked up book number 40, chapter number 40. And I said, now this is supposed to match up with the book of Matthew. So I said, is there anything in there that would match up with Matthew? So I started reading, comfort ye my people, saith the Lord, comfort ye my people, comfort ye my people, saith the Lord. And then I got down there to verse 3, and it says, the voice of him that crieth in the wilderness. I turn over to Matthew, and I turn over to Matthew chapter 3, and up shows John the Baptist, and what does he say? He says, I'm the voice of the one crying in the wilderness to make straight the way of the Lord. Now that's a pretty strong coincidence, isn't it? I mean, wow, that's amazing. So, chapter 3 of Matthew, there you have John the Baptist showing up. Verse 3, this is the one spoken of by Isaiah the prophet. So that's kind of an interesting Bible study. Now, like I said, it doesn't always match up, but there's some interesting things. For example, the 66th chapter of the Bible would line up with the book of Revelation. You go to Isaiah chapter 66, you get toward the end of that chapter, and it's talking about a new heavens and a new earth. Just like the book of Revelation talks about a new heaven and a new earth. So that's pretty interesting. Pretty interesting. Another thing, this is a new thing that I've heard people talking about, is that you can take the book of Psalms, and you read through the book of Psalms, and each chapter, I think there's 150 chapters in the book of Psalms, you try to line those up with the years, or the days, dates. Now I've tried to do that. It's kind of interesting, but I don't know how far you can go with that. So let's say the year 2000, they say that that would be Psalm 100. So then they say, so Psalms 117 would be 2017. Now people say, we think that the rapture will be in Psalm 2017. So you go to 2017 in the book of Psalms, it would be 117, and you look and it's only two verses. And this is one of the shortest chapters, if not the shortest chapter, in the entire Bible. Yet all these other chapters in Psalms all deal with Israel. So they said 2017, the rapture, because, and so they try. But it doesn't always match up, but it is interesting. 2018 would be Psalms 118. Psalms 118. And you read Psalm 118, and that sure sounds like the nation of Israel rebuilding their temple and building that up again. So I don't go too in detail with this, but some people do, and that's a way that they study their Bible. So that, I just throw that in for extra, just something interesting to look at, see what you think about that. The other way to study the Bible is prophetically. Prophetically. You can have a lot of fun studying the Bible. If you go to the Old Testament, and all throughout this Old Testament, you have all these prophets. And a lot of these prophets prophesy. And it's fun to go to Ezekiel. It's fun to go to Isaiah. It's fun to read these Old Testament prophets and try to find out where they were fulfilled in the future and where they will be fulfilled in the future. A lot of people contact me and say, what do you think about the Ezekiel 37 and 38 war that's coming up soon? You know, and I'm like, well, I don't know. But they read those Old Testament prophecies and they say, that sounds like something that's going to happen here, either right before the rapture or over here. So there's a lot of prophecy in the Bible, and it's fun sometimes to do Bible studies and read and try to look up those old prophecies. Eventually, I'd like to get a message which I show some of the Old Testament prophecies fulfilled by Jesus from the Old Testament, and where I try to give some prophecies back here also that apply here to the future, and show you those as well. So hopefully I'll be able to do that. Now, finally, the last way to study the Bible is by rightly dividing. And a lot of people do not rightly divide the Word of God. A lot of people aren't dispensationalists, so they don't rightly divide. But a lot of people, they don't rightly divide either the Scriptures and realize, hey, we're not under the law anymore, we're under grace. You see, we're not saved by works, we're saved by grace through faith. It's faith that saves. And you need to learn how to rightly divide the Word of Truth. Because God gave to Paul something that He didn't give to anybody else. And God told Paul to preach something for salvation today that He didn't say to anybody else. I would refer you to last week's sermon. It's entitled The Great Commission, ? And then the sermon before that, on the one about, drawing a blank, the Apostles' Doctrine. Watch that video as well, because what you find is that God called this man named Paul and told Paul, here, Paul, you're the apostle to the Gentiles. You're the one to go out and to preach this gospel of salvation. And 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is the gospel of salvation today. And I'll close with this. 1 Corinthians 15 says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, by which also you received, and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures. So the gospel is so clear. It's so clear that Jesus died, but it's not just that Jesus died. The gospel is how Jesus died. How did Jesus die? He shed His blood. And He did it for our sins. So you've got to rightly divide the Word of Truth and the gospel. And the gospel is that Christ died for our sins, was buried and rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. How did He die for our sins? He shed His blood for us. And if you'll trust the blood atonement of Christ, then you're saved. You see, this is the way of salvation today. It's this gospel. It's not what we do that gets us to heaven. Many denominations, they read the Bible, they study the Bible, but they never come to a knowledge of the truth. They never come to salvation. They're over here in the law somewhere, or they're over back here in a different dispensation trying to apply that to themselves when they should be coming over here to Paul, because God said, Paul, you're the one that I'm revealing the way to be saved in this dispensation or this time. So you need to go out and tell people how to get saved. People need to see that. Romans 2:16 says, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to my gospel. So someday people will be judged by whether or not they accepted Paul's gospel. So are you saved? You might be someone that studies and reads the Bible, but unless you come to this gospel of salvation, then you're not saved. So let me close with this. This is how to read or study the Bible. There's a lot of different ways to read or study the Bible. You ought to read it daily. You ought to read it dispensationally. It's fun to read it sometimes chronologically. You ought to realize that there is an order of the books in the Bible because that's the order that history will come to pass. You can read Isaiah, you can read Psalms, read Proverbs one a day. Read it prophetically, but make sure you, when you read the Bible, that you rightly divide, not wrongly divide the word of truth. Let's go to Romans 15:4 and close with this. I've had people tell me, well, you're so much into Paul that you don't even love the Old Testament. You don't read the Old Testament. You're just anti-Old Testament and anti-law. No, I read the Old Testament because God said these things. Look at Romans 15:4. He said, but whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the Scriptures might have hope. So God gave us both an Old Testament and a New Testament to study and read. The Old Testament shows us clearly the coming Christ. And it shows us that we're sinners. The law shows us that we're such big sinners, we cannot keep the law. So the Old Testament was there, but the Old Testament also has a lot of stories about men. And a lot of stories about, hey, this guy did this sin, and this guy did this sin, and this guy, look what happened to them. Well, guess what that is? That's an example to us. Hey, don't do what that guy did, or that'll happen to you too. So that's one of the reasons I love the Old Testament. There's a lot of good stories back there, instructions on how not to do things. For example, David committed adultery. It cost him fourfold. I don't want to commit adultery. I don't want to have to pay fourfold for something that I did in the flesh. So the Old Testament is there. A lot of people say, well, you only believe in reading and preaching the New Testament. That's not true. I believe in reading the whole Bible. But I believe we read it and we study it. And we understand it rightly divided. So I appreciate you watching. This is a little bit shorter video, but this will hopefully be a blessing to you as you yourself read and study the Word of God. And I hope you do. I hope you read the Bible. I hope you study the Bible. Let me get out of your way. A lot of people want a screenshot, so here it is. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time.